God for the praise team, wonderful job.
God bless.
Amen. Voice is so strong. Amen. Thank God for Red jumping on the drums and keyboard.
Thank you.
And I want to encourage you, if you feel in your heart, God just telling you to go up to Red and give him something, give him something.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Because he jumped on both of them back and forth.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. That's what I feel in my heart to say about him. If you feel in your heart, God telling you to go up to him and give him something, give him something.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Because the labor is worthy of his wages.
Yes, Lord.
Amen. Hebrews the second chapter, verse 1 through 4 and 9 and 10. And I will be out your way.
Yes, Lord.
Hebrews the second chapter, verse 1 through 4 and 9 and 10. When you have that, could you please say amen.
Amen.
I believe Hebrews is before the book of James to you Bible scholars out there.
Yes,
amen. Yes, Lord. You may can help pass down a little bit then. Hebrews the second chapter, verse 1 through 4, 9 and 10. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by our angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how should we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, God also bearing them witness, both with signs and wonders, and with divers miracles, and gifts of the Holy Ghost, according to his own will. Look at verse 9 and 10. But we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than the angels, for the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, that he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. For it became him, or it pleased him, for whom are all things, and by whom are all things, and bring him and his sons unto glory, to make the captain of their salvation perfect through suffering.
Glory.
Look at your neighbor, say, neighbor.
Looking unto Jesus,
the captain of your salvation.
Come
on, say it with some scripture, neighbor. Looking unto Jesus,
the captain
of your salvation. One time, say, neighbor.
Looking unto Jesus,
the captain of your salvation.
Amen.
Saints of God, even on this Sunday, I want to redirect your focus once again. To redirect your focus to King Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Whatever you got your eyes on right now, or whoever you got your eyes on right now, take your eyes off it and off them and put your eyes on King Jesus.
Yeah.
When we look around the saints of God and we see the mayhem that's going on in our community, we see what's going on in our nation. We see what's going on in our schools. We see what's going on in our home, saints of God. We got to look to Jesus.
Yes.
Sometimes we're looking in the wrong places and we're looking at the wrong people, and we have taken our eyes off King Jesus.
Yes.
There was a couple in New York, I believe this week, that jumped from the ninth floor, husband and wife, jumped from the ninth floor and killed themselves.
Yes.
And they left a note behind. They had children. They left the children behind. Left the children inside of the apartment. Left a note behind and said, take care of our children. But they said, we can't take this because we in debt and we can't pay our insurance. But they took their lives because they wasn't looking to King Jesus. They was looking at the situation, but they wasn't looking at God. It says to God, I want to encourage your hearts today. Don't you be concerned about what's going on in the political system. Don't you be concerned about what's going on in our economic system, in our educational system.
Yes.
Be with me, says God. The Bible said that on Jesus' shoulders is the government.
Yes.
That Jesus is not on the shoulder of the government, but the government is on the shoulders of Jesus. And saints of God, you got to trust in God to provide for you.
Yes.
Because he is Jehovah Jireh. He is the God that will provide.
Yes.
Young and I'm old. He said, never have I seen the righteous forsaken or receive begging bread. If God is going to take care of his honor, you don't need to give up. You don't need to throw in the towel. You don't need to turn your back on God, but you need to keep your attention focused on King Jesus.
Yes.
Saints of God, I want to encourage you today to make sure that you put your attention on the right person.
Hallelujah.
Put your attention on King Jesus. All he is a keeper if you let him keep you.
Hallelujah.
He'll be your peace in the midst of the storm.
Yes,
he'll be your joy in the midst of sorrow. He'll be water in dry places. He'll be a rock in a river land.
Hallelujah.
He'll be your earache in the time of battle.
Yes,
but you have to look to King Jesus.
Yes,
all he'll be the bright morning star.
Yes,
he'll be your guardian. So you hear me? He'll give you direction. You got to look to King Jesus. I'm talking about the authenticity of your faith. I'm talking about King Jesus.
Yes.
And the bright morning star.
Hallelujah.
Who here says, God, you have to keep your attention focused on King Jesus.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Oh my God. And here in the Hebrews, the second chapter, he's telling you where to direct your focus. He's telling you, I want you to get ready to keep your eyes on Jesus. Saints of God, I'm telling you, if you got your eyes on something else, and got your eyes on your bills, and got your eyes on who don't like you, and got your eyes on who loves you, let me tell you, you better put your eyes back on King Jesus. And he told them here in Hebrews, the second chapter, the first verse, he said, therefore we ought to give the Lord earnest heed to the things which we have heard. Therefore, we ought to. You ought to give heed to the things that you heard. Some of us do not know what we ought to do. We think we ought to go certain places, and we think we ought to do certain things, and we think we ought to say certain things, and we think we ought to think certain ways. But the writer said, you ought to give more earnest heed to the things which you have heard. We got to know what we ought to do. We got to be like the sons of Issachar. We got to understand the times that we are in. Yes. And the Bible said we need to know what we need to do. And right now, saints of God, what you need to do, you need to look up to Jesus.
Salvation.
He said, we ought to give the most earnest heed. Mm-hmm. You got to give heed to the things of God. Yes. Some of us give heed to everything else, but we don't give heed to the word of God. We give heed to our jobs, but we don't give heed to the word of God. We give heed to our boo, our husband, our wife, but we don't give heed to our job. Yes. We give heed to our bank account, but we don't give heed to our God. We give heed to our children, but we don't give heed to our God. He said, we need to give heed.
Oh, yes. My God.
Yes, Lord.
Give the most earnest heed to the things which we have heard.
Yes, Lord.
Go to Luke, the 8th chapter, the 18th verse. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Give heed to the things which you have heard. Give heed to the things which you have heard. Luke, the 8th chapter, verse 18 says, take heed, therefore, how you hear. For whosoever had, to him shall be given. And to whosoever have not, from him shall be taken even that which he seemed to have. He said, listen, I want you to give the most earnest heed to what you already heard. Saints of God, we are not giving heed to what Jesus has already spoken to us. Here in Luke, the 8th chapter, he began to speak about the soul went out to sow. And he sowed on the wayside, and the birds were there that came, and they ate up. He said he sowed on hard ground. It was earth underneath, do you hear me? It was rock underneath it. He said, then he sowed among thorns. Do you hear me, saints of God? He said, he was speaking about how a person here. He said, don't be like people who got their wayside sowed. I'm talking about that when the seed is sown, the devil come and snatch what was given to you. These are people who got their wayside heart, where the word of God is sown into their heart. But before they get outside the house of God, the devil come and snatch what God had made them. He said, don't be like those where the seed is sown. He said, but it's sown into the soil, but underneath is hard rock. These are people, he said, when you sow the seed, the plant grow quick. But he said the plant died because the plant don't get no root in the ground. These are people who hear the word of God, but they never let the word of God get root down inside their spirit. Therefore, they never produce no fruit. You got to hear the right way. Didn't hear the saints God. He said, don't be like those where they sowed seed among thorns. And the thorns came up and choked it. Do you hear me?
Yes,
he said, these are people who hear the word, but they keep caring about the cares of this world.
Yes,
you're concerned about your car, and concerned about your Gucci, and concerned about your polo, and your football. Do you hear me? You're concerned about what they're doing at the house party, and what they're doing at the club. Do you hear me? And this is the reason why I come to, and that the cares of this world will come up and choke the word that was spoken to you.
Yeah.
But Jesus said, I want you to be careful of how you hear. He said, when you hear the word of God, I want you to get ready to produce some fruit. Do you hear me, saints God?
Yes.
Beware how you hear. When Jesus is speaking to you, do you hear me, saints God? You got to beware of how you hear. You got to make sure that you just don't hear the word, but you do the word. Listen, faith without works is dead. You can hear the word all you want to, but if you don't implement the word, it don't mean anything. Sometimes we have fat saints in the spirit.
Yes.
They sit up on a whole little anointing.
Yes.
And all their word and get fat. And they never produce fruit. You know how come they never produce fruit? It's because they never chew that word up and digest it.
Sir.
You hear me, saints of God?
Yes.
You just filled with a whole bunch of word. But you ain't trying to digest that word.
On,
you hear me, saints of God? You ain't trying to walk in the fruit of the spirit. When we hear the word of God, we should be aiming to please God.
Yes.
Take heed of how you hear.
How you hear? My God.
Don't just hear what your ears but hear with your spiritual ears.
Yes, Lord.
Let him that have ears to hear it. Hear what the Spirit of God is saying to the church. You hear me, saints of God? When we get the word of God, we have to be aware of how we hear it. Mm-hmm. Least at any time, mm-hmm. we should let them slip. What God said, you let it slip.
My God.
What God spoke to you, you let it slip. Mm. What God said to you, it went through one ear and went out the other, you let it slip.
My God.
He said, beware that the word don't slip. Slip means to drift away.
Uh-huh.
Do you hear me, saints of God?
Yes.
Because I can tell you when a saint has not embraced that word and they let that word slip away because they begin to drift away.
My God.
They begin to drift away from the things of God.
Yes.
He said when you don't take heed to what the word say, you find yourself drifting away. Now you ain't coming to Bible study no more.
Yes.
Now you don't come in for prayer no more. You know why? Because now you're getting ready to drift away.
My God.
He said, listen, be careful that you don't let the word slip. Don't let it drift away.
My God.
It means slip means to fall away from duty.
Yes.
You can tell when you have allowed the word of God to slip in your life because you begin to fall away from your duty in God.
Oh,
when God had come first, you used to come, you used to clean the church up, you used to be faithful, but now you have let the word of God slip, and now you have pulled back from your duty in God.
Yes.
I can tell you when the word of God has slipped away because you begin to slip away from your duty.
Yes.
You don't want to pray no more. You don't want to fast no more. You don't want to seek God no more. You ain't giving God no praise no more. The saints got their hands lifted up in the house of God, but you have neglected your duty, because you have allowed the word of God to slip away.
Yes,
yes, slip means to lapse into spiritual defeat.
Yes,
it means to slowly move away from Christ.
Yes.
When people are slowly moving away from Christ, it means to go along with the world. You know when a person is moving away from Christ because they're going along with the world.
Uh-huh.
Everything in the world excites them. Do you hear me, saints of God? But when you let the word of God slip,
yes,
you begin to move away from Christ.
Yes,
you begin to slip away, drifting past the destination because you pushed along by the current.
Yes.
Jesus is your anchor.
Yes,
the anchor is what keeps the boat in place. But if you cut the anchor, guess what? The boat will drift on down the sea. Do you hear me? Some of us have gotten away from Jesus, and now the currents of life is pushing us down the sea. Do you hear me?
Yes.
The destination that God wants you to be at, you find yourself moving away from that destination.
Yes.
The place in the spirit where God wants you to be at, you find yourself moving from that destination.
Yes.
Because you have allowed the currents of this world to cut the anchor. Say so, God, don't let the currents of this world cut your anchor inside of King Jesus.
My God.
Yes, Lord, yes, Lord.
When you have allowed the word to slip away,
my God,
I'm going to speak to some people. Your body is in that seat,
yes,
but your spirit is already gone.
Yes, oh, Lord. My God.
And what I mean by that, you clapping your hands, but you ain't in God.
Yes,
you shouting and dancing, you put on a good show, but you have been let the word slip away.
Yes,
and your body is there, but you are not in God. Do you hear me, saints of God? You have no desire and no passion for the things of God. We come into the house of God and our body is here, but we've been gone a long time ago. And it's just a matter of time before we finally leave outside God's house. And let me show you what we do so you can know this person going to try to do this before they do it. And you'll say, Pastor already said he was going to do this. This is a person, when a person has already backslid in their heart, and a person in the spirit, they're already gone and their body's still there. These are people who sit inside of the house of God and they trying to find some fault with the pastor, trying to find some fault with the usher, trying to find some fault with somebody so I can go ahead and leave. And that's your excuse that you're trying to have. All the pastor shouldn't say it there. The usher shouldn't say it there. She should have said that to me. I don't like the way that the pastor said that. But really deep inside your spirit, you was already gone.
You
had
already
drifted away. Didn't you say so God? You had already got away from the word of God.
My God, my God.
We're already gone. We just wait for a reason. Did you hear me say to God?
My God.
We wait to get into an argument with the pastor, somebody. You know why? Because God, there's a reason why I come, I'm gone.
Yes.
But really, you have already drifted away from the things of God.
My God. Yes, Lord. Yeah.
Lord.
Because you're not giving earnest heed to the word of God that's spoken. What God is speaking to you is going through one ear and going out the other. It's not going down inside your spirit.
Jesus.
That you already don't drift it away.
Yes,
you're here physically, but spiritually, you're already gone. But he said, I want you to give the most earnest heed.
Mm-hmm.
least at any time, we should let them slip. Oh my God. For if the word spoken by angels were steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a recompense of reward. Uh-huh. He said when the angels spoke the word in Old Testament, whatever they say, if you disobey the word, he said judgment came immediately.
Yes.
He said the word spoken by angels stood in place. He said, what do you think will happen when the Lord himself is speaking the word to us?
Yes,
he even says God. He said, how? Look at verse 3. How should we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Just like it was in the days of Noah. There was eating and drinking. I know we don't want to hear this kind of preaching.
Come on.
Because we don't want to get prepared for the Lord to come back.
My God.
Pastor, just scratch my ears. I can't scratch your ears.
Yes, come
on. You hear me say, God. Just like it was in the days of Noah. There was eating and they was drinking. There was married. They was giving in marriage. They was going to the parties. Do you hear me? They were dropping like it was hot. They was riding on 24s. You hear me say to God? They were doing everything up on the sun until God called Noah and signed them off. Just like it was in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah. They was eating and drinking. They had businesses. They was married and giving in marriage until God called Lot outside of Sodom and Gomorrah. And fire came down from God and destroyed the city. Come on, saints of God. If they didn't escape, guess what? We ain't going to escape. If the angels who sinned against God, if God cast them down to hell, guess what? If they didn't escape, guess what? We ain't going to escape. He said, you're not going to escape so great salvation.
My God, my God.
How should we escape if we neglect?
Yes,
this is the problem right here. The reason why we reject God's great salvation is because we neglect him.
Oh, God.
Come on, saints of God.
Yes.
We neglect what God is saying. Neglect means I am careless of.
Oh God.
We are careless of the word of God. We hear the word of God and we careless of God's word.
God
speaks to us and we know God's speaking to us, but we become careless with the word of God. We careless with the anointing of God. We don't count the anointing of God as being anything. Do you hear me? We don't count the anointing of God as being precious. God put his anointing on us and we go right outside the house of God and jump in the bed with somebody you know God because we're careless of the things of God. We neglect the things of God. Neglect means to disregard. We cannot have disregard for the word of God. I hear the word of God being spoken, but I got disregard for the word of God.
Yes, yes, Lord.
Neglect means to be without concern.
Uh-huh.
We're not concerned about the things of God. Yes, we shout, but we ain't concerned about the things of God. Yes, we dance around the church, but we concerned about the things of God. Yes, we show up at prayer, but we concerned about the things of God. Yes, we sing on a praise scene, but we concerned about the things of God. We have neglected of great salvation. We care more about our bank account than we care about our own soul. We care more about our car that we drive and the wheels that we own more than we care about our own soul. We care about our job more than we care about our own soul. We care about our clothes. Do you hear me say so? We care about our bling bling more than we care about our own soul. We got a generation, we got a people who have neglected their great salvation.
Yes.
They don't care nothing about their soul. They concerned about what I'm going to do tomorrow and what I'm going to eat tomorrow and what's going to happen at the job tomorrow and what's going to happen in the family tomorrow. They're not concerned about their salvation. But saints of God, you got to get to a place where you care about your salvation.
Yes.
Don't you neglect so great a salvation.
Yes.
When Jesus was wounded for your transgressions.
Oh,
when he was bruised for your iniquities, when the chastisement of our peace was upon him, and by his stripes we are healed. I'm talking about Jesus, the one who they put a crown of thorns on his head. I'm talking about Jesus, the one that they slapped around and spit in his face, not for his sins, but for your sins. I'm talking about Jesus, the one they lied on, the one that they betrayed. I'm talking about Jesus, the one they nailed to the cross, nailed his hand to the cross, nailed his feet to the cross, not for what he did, but for what you did. I'm talking about Jesus, who they stuck a spear in his side. And the Bible said, out of his side came blood and water.
Yes.
Not for what he did, but for what you did.
My God.
The same Jesus had that other little shade that they took down from the cross and put in a tomb. Who rose up with all power. That same Jesus who came and died for you. Sometimes we count what Jesus did as a small thing.
A small
thing. We neglect so great of salvation.
That's the truth.
We disregard. Mm. There have been people we have gave things to, we prayed and fasted over, and you see them and they don't throw it away.
Yes,
you disregard the things of God.
Yes, Lord.
Don't get no kind of honor for the things of God.
Jesus.
But we neglect.
Yes, Lord. Mm, my
Viewing as insignificance.
Jesus.
The Bible said, don't give what is holy to the dogs.
Yes, Lord.
And don't throw your pearl before swine.
Yes, Lord.
Because some saints of God, some people in the house of God got a dog spirit.
Jesus.
And what I mean by a dog spirit, if you throw something precious to a dog, guess what? He don't see the value in that. He'll tear it up. Don't throw your prayer before swine. You throw your prayer before swine. I'm talking about pigs. They stump them under their feet. They keep on eating. You know why? Because they don't see the value in a pearl.
Yes,
and sometimes in the house of God, says God, some of us have a dog spirit and have a swine spirit. Mm-hmm. I can tell you when you don't care about the things of God, when you don't care about the anointing of God, when you don't care about the word of God, you got a dog spirit. You got a swine spirit. What I'm not concerned about, things that's holy.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
Person give me a prayer show, and I just throw it on the floor.
Ooh.
Person give me some anointing oil, they gonna pray and fast over the world. I don't even know where it's at right now. God give me a word, guess what? I reject everything God said.
God
anoint me and fill me with the Holy Ghost. I go get in the bed with Jack the same day. It don't make no difference to me. You know why? Because we do not count the anointing of God as being precious.
Yeah.
And I'm talking to somebody right now that you need to get rid of that dog spirit and get rid of that swine spirit so you can count the things of God as being precious.
My God.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
You got to guard your heart.
Yes, Lord.
You got to guard the anointing. Pastor, I guard the anointing that's on my life because I know how precious it is. When you realize what Jesus had to go through for you, do you even say, God, you start counting the things of God as being precious.
Yes,
and some of you need to stop throwing what is holy to the dogs and start giving your prayer before swine.
Yes, my God.
Because you've given them wisdom, but they don't want it.
Yes, Lord. Oh, Jesus.
The Bible said, at least they turn and bite you.
Help us, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
You get something precious to us. Swine, he'll turn around and bite your hand.
Yes,
these are people that you give the word to, the precious word to, and they turn around and attack you.
My God.
They turn around and backstab you. You know why? But they don't count that thing as being precious, what you just gave to them.
Yes.
And I want to help you, saints of God. Stop giving stuff to people when you know they got a dog spirit and a swine spirit. Leave them alone.
Yes.
Just pray for them and keep it moving.
Yes.
Because they don't want God. Some people ain't doing it, but wasting your time.
Yes, Lord.
Calling you on the phone and they don't got no attention on doing what God wants them to do. Tell them about all their problems, and when you tell them what the word say, they still don't do what God tell them to do. Because they got a dog spirit and a swine spirit. I don't got nothing else to tell you. If you call me, I'm going to give you the word of God.
Yes.
If you talk to me, I'm going to give you the word of God.
Yes. My God. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Hallelujah, Lord.
But we neglect so great salvation.
Oh, yes.
I don't know what kind of salvation we got today. This generation. Because the salvation we got today is not the salvation that the old saints had. Because salvation, oh my God, means to be saved.
Yes.
It means to be delivered.
Yes.
Sometimes this generation, we say we saved and can't nobody even tell it.
Tell it.
We're not the light of the world. We're not the salt of the earth.
Come on.
Somebody look at you and they say, you're doing the same thing I'm doing.
Come on.
And you say you saved. What are you saved from? Because to be saved is to be snatched out of the hand of the enemy.
Yes.
When you say that I'm saved, you say I'm delivered.
Yes.
When you say I'm saved, you say I don't go to the clubs no more.
Mm-hmm.
I don't go to the house parties anymore. I don't sleep around without being married.
Yes.
Come on, saints of God, because you say I'm saved.
Mm-hmm.
But we got a generation who don't know what saved means.
Yes.
But to save the salvation that I saw that the earlier saints had,
my God,
they was delivered.
They was delivered.
Salvation means healing. We say that we saved, but we still ain't healed. Come on, saints of God. We say that we saved, but we still ain't delivered. If you're saved, God will deliver you from danger and deliver you into safety. That's what it means to be saved. I'm saved from what I was doing. I'm saved from drinking alcohol. I'm saved from sexual immorality. I'm saved from going to the club. I'm saved from going to the house party. Come on, saints of God. This is the reason why this generation don't know what saved me. Because now we're not preaching the word of God anymore.
Come on.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Just give your money and everything okay.
Come on.
And if you want pastor to say that you're still going to heaven and you're in the bed with somebody else's wife, I'll go ahead and say that. Just pay your tithes and offering. Because now we got some hireling shepherds.
Uh-huh.
And a hireling shepherd is a hireling shepherd because he only preach when you pay him.
Yes.
But we need true shepherds. We need the saints of God.
Yes.
God said I would give them pastors after my own heart who will feed them with knowledge.
Yes.
We need true shepherds that's going to stand up and
tell you,
it's holiness or it's hell.
Yes.
Jesus is coming back for a church for us by the regal. The Bible said, come out from among them and be separated. Why are we coming to the house of God to hear a bunch of lies? last days they will heap up themselves teachers having itch in ears. They will give heed to fables. Fables is a fancy story. I just want the pastor to tell me a fancy story. Come on, man, hit the keyboard and pastor tell me a fancy story. And let me go ahead and leave out the door, but you don't got no substance. You don't got no word in your head. You haven't scored. You ain't revived. You ain't felt the presence of God. You ain't felt the power of God. You don't know nothing about the emotional God. You don't know nothing about the word of spirit. Come on, say to God, you still don't know Jesus.
The truth.
You gotta forgive, Pastor, today because I feel this on me. Because God is trying to correct somebody. Do you hear me say to God? God said, redirect your focus. Don't let my word slip. Don't treat my word as if it's nothing. Well, my son gave his life for you. Do you hear me say to God? We have neglected. It's not that we can't be saved. We neglected. We don't even want it. We disregard it. Anything that God do, we disregard it. God hear you. You go out the door. They've been peeping here that God have healed them right on the altar. They went out the door and went right back and started living wrong. People came in. Burden was on them. We prayed for them. The burden lifted off. The devil left. Guess what? They went right back out the door and kept doing the same old thing. You know why? Because they neglect what God want to give them.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Jesus, yes, Lord.
Jesus. Neglect so great a salvation.
Yes, Lord.
Which is the first begin to be spoken by the Lord.
Yes.
Oh, my God. Angels are not speaking no more. Now Jesus is speaking.
Come on.
Was confirmed unto them that heard him. God also bare them witness both with signs and wonders, with divers miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. Jesus, when Jesus gave them the word, Jesus said, I did not come to speak my own words, but I came to speak what the Father wanted me to speak. Then he said, I'm going to send back the Holy Ghost. Let me give you an understanding now. He said, I'm going to send back the Holy Ghost. He said, when the Holy Ghost comes, the Holy Ghost ain't going to talk about himself. He said, the Holy Ghost is going to speak about me. He said, the Holy Ghost comes to glorify me, Jesus. Every time somebody get healed in the house of God, it's for Jesus to be glorified. It ain't for man to be glorified. It ain't for woman to be glorified. When you see miracles in the house of God, and you see the power of God, you hear the word of God, it's for King Jesus to be glorified.
Yes.
He said, the Holy Ghost is going to bring to remember the things that I say.
Hallelujah.
When we read in the word of God, every time you see red, it's Jesus speaking. We live by the teachings of Jesus. The things that were spoken by the Lord himself. God started sending prophets back in the past. You didn't listen to them. God started sending angels in the past. You didn't listen to them. God started sending great men and great women of God. And God said, you won't listen to them. But God said, now I'm giving you one more chance. He said, I'm going to send my son. He said, my express image, because Jesus is the express image of God. He said, I'm going to send my son. He said, I'm going to speak through my son. He said, don't reject the word that come out of my son's mouth. But yet, when it was there on the Mount of Transfiguration,
my God.
The Bible said that Moses and Elijah appeared right there with Jesus while they was talking.
Right.
And the Bible said a great cloud came over their head.
Yes.
And God said, this is my beloved son. He said, listen to him. We hear him say, God, we got to listen to Jesus.
Yes.
Stop listening to people on your job and listen to Jesus. Yes. Stop listening to your homeboys or homegirls and listen to Jesus. Stop listening to their ex-boyfriend or ex-girlfriend and listen to Jesus.
Yes,
God confirmed this word
with
signs and wonders and miracles.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes,
you say, how do I know Jesus is real? How do I know that he lives? When you see somebody getting healed right in your midst, you know Jesus lives.
Yes,
we had people here get healed. The reason why God healed them, because God wanted them to know that Jesus lives. Do you hear me say to God? He said God confirmed his word with miracle signs and wonders. Where are the miracle signs and wonders in the house of God? You know how come you don't see the healings of God and you don't feel the spirit of God moving? You know why? Because they're not lifting up Jesus. I'm not talking about anybody. I'm just being truthful now, saying to God. They're listening to dead presidents. And what we come up on a parking lot drive in. And what I'm wearing, do you hear me? We have lifted this up. And we have not lifted up King Jesus.
Come on
saying to God. But when we lift up King Jesus, you'll see miracles. You'll see wild signs. You'll see wonder. You'll see the power of God. You'll hear the word of God. You'll be strengthened. You'll be restored. You'll be revived in the house of God.
My God.
God bearing a witness.
Yes,
God said, I give you witness that I'm for real because I just healed you.
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Yes,
look at verse 9.
Yes,
because he began to tell them here in this chapter, he said, God put everything on a man's feet.
Mm-hmm.
Yes,
everything that God created, he put up on a man's feet.
Yes,
go back to Genesis. God said, let us make men in our image and in our likeness, and let them have dominion over fish of the sea.
Mm-hmm.
Let them have dominion over birds of the air. Let them have dominion over cattle of the field.
Mm-hmm.
Let them have dominion over every creeping thing. Let them have dominion over all the earth. I want to speak towards men. Because we lost something in the Garden of Eden. We lost dominion that God gave us. Somebody said, what is a man? Because we kill people in the name of I'm a man. We do stuff crazy because I'm trying to be a man. We drink a little gin to try to get some hair on our chest because I'm trying to be a man. But I want to tell you what a man is. Because God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. If you want to know what a man is, go back to the one that made man. Go back to Genesis. Go back to the beginning. Because God said, let us make man in our image and in our likeness. If you want to know what a man is the image and likeness of God.
Come on. Yes, sir.
If you really want to know what a man is, a man is the image and likeness of God.
Yes.
A man is not somebody who get out there and shoot somebody and fight somebody and be mean and hateful. No, a man is the image and likeness of God, a likeness of God. God created us in his image and likeness.
Yes,
Lord. Say, rule, subdue, and conquer.
Yes, sir.
Man, I'm supposed to be up on anything. We're supposed to have dominion. I know you don't see this right now.
Yes, Lord.
Because we have dominion over vegetation.
Yes.
Over the fruit of the field. Over the animals. Over the lions, the bears, the elephant, giraffe. God gave Adam dominion. Better yet, Adam named all the animals.
Yeah.
Which signified that he had dominion over them. Yeah. God brought all the animals to Adam. And Adam said, that's a giraffe, that's an elephant. He said, that's a lion. He said, that's going to be a tiger right there. He said, this is going to be a hyena. He said, this is going to be a wild dog. Look, he began to name all of them. He said, this is going to be a bear, this is going to be a polar bear, this is going to be a grizzly bear. He began to name them, and God didn't say anything. You know why? Because he was created in God's image and likeness. He had the mind of God.
Yes.
And when he had to name them, God didn't say nothing. But when he named them, he showed that he had dominion over it.
Yes, Lord.
My God.
But when he sinned, man fell from grace.
Yes, Lord.
You hear me say, to God?
Yes.
Man failed. But God sent Jesus to redeem us. Do you hear me? To restore us through his blood so we can have dominion all over again.
Yes, Lord.
He said, you don't see this now.
Uh-huh.
He said, you don't understand this now. But in verse 9, he said, but what you need to do to get a revelation about this, he said, but we see Jesus.
Yes.
If you look unto Jesus, you'll see the dominion that God had gave man. Yes. You got to find this thing wrapped up inside of Jesus.
Yes.
Do you hear me say, God? I'm talking about Jesus.
Yes.
I'm talking about the bread of life. Because bread of life means substance of life.
Yes.
I'm talking about Jesus, the light of the world. You need Jesus to be the light of the world to bring illumination inside of your life.
Yes.
I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about the true vine. Come on, say to God. Because the true vine is your source. I'm talking about Jesus. Was made flesh. In the beginning was the Word.
Uh-huh.
And the Word was God. And the Word was with God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us.
Yes.
I'm talking about Jesus. You need the Word of God.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I'm talking about the bright morning star.
Yeah.
The bright morning star is the brightest star.
Yes,
it's a star that gives travelers direction and give them guidance.
Yes,
you need Jesus to bring guidance inside of your life.
Come on,
I'm talking about the good shepherd who feeds you the Word of God. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about the bread of life. I'm talking about God's bringing me to Jesse. I'm talking about the Lamb of God. I'm talking about your great high priest. Come on, say, God. I'm talking about Jesus. He says, looking unto Jesus, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, ruler of rulers, emperor of emperors. I'm talking about the great high priest. I'm talking about the apostle of our profession. I'm talking about Jesus, the Son of God. I'm talking about Emmanuel.
I'm talking
about the Prince of Peace. I'm talking about the wonderful counselor.
Yeah.
Do you hear me say, God? We have to look unto Jesus.
Hallelujah. Yes, Lord.
Look unto your shield.
Yeah,
look unto your buckler. Look unto your strong tower.
Yes, Lord.
Do you hear me? Look at your water in dry places. Because Jesus is living water.
Hey, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
He said, but seeing Jesus.
Oh, yes, God.
Seeing means to look at. I'm looking at King Jesus.
Hallelujah.
The author and finisher of my faith.
My God.
While I'm running this race, I'm looking up to Jesus, the author and finisher of my faith.
Yes.
I cannot be distracted because Peter was distracted.
Yes, Lord.
Remember that night on the boat?
Yes.
And he stepped out on water in a word from God.
Uh-huh.
And he began to walk on water. Peter is the only other man that we know about that walked on water.
My God.
He walked on water going to Jesus. But the reason why he was walking on water was because he had got a word from the Lord. And when God gave him that word, he said, come. With one word, he said, come.
Come.
One word, God can change your whole life.
Yes.
One word, he gave Peter one word. He stepped out the boat and started walking on water.
Yes.
One word from God, and God can save your children. One word from God, and God can heal your mind.
Yes.
God gave me and my wife one word about our marriage. God said, leave. And when he lived, guess what? It'd been almost 20 years later. You know why? Because of one word from God. Peter walked on water. Getting close to Jesus. Closer. None of them surrender. Closer to Jesus. But as he got closer, the Bible said he was distracted. Because the winds was and the waves was clashing. And he took his eyes out of Jesus for a split second. And when he did, he began to sink. Oh my God. Sometimes you take your eyes out of Jesus, that's when you start going down. You start going down in depression, and going down in confusion, and going down in fear, and going down in defeat. You start sinking. But he said something. When you know you have took your eyes out of Jesus, and you know you have neglected his word, and you know you have not been down in a place of prayer. When you find yourself starting to sink, the Bible said that Peter told Jesus, Lord, save me.
Yes.
And say to God, this is what some of us need to say right now.
Yes.
You need to say, God, save me.
Yes.
God, I need you to save me. Yes. I need you to deliver me. Yes. I need you to revive me. I need you to restore me. I need you to heal me. Come on, say to God,
yes.
Lord, save me.
Hallelujah.
Save me from my disposition.
Save
me from my attitude. By the wind that was blowing.
Yeah.
I got distracted, oh God, by the rain that was crashing around my feet, oh God. And I have to admit, I began to sing.
Yeah.
I have to admit, oh God, that I have neglected your word and got outside your presence. I'm going to say some God,
yeah.
But I know the words to say, Lord, save me.
Yes, yes, Lord. My God. Hallelujah, Jesus.
Deliver me from.
Yeah.
I can't do this on my own.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I can't break the habit on my own.
Yes,
I can't lift the burden on my own.
Yes, Lord.
I can't destroy the yoke on my own. Lord, save me.
Praise
because
God.
You are Jesus.
Yes,
you are my Savior.
Yeah.
You are my Redeemer.
Yes,
let the name of the Lord say so.
Yes,
you shed your blood for me.
Yes.
I was not bought with silver or gold, but I was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. You can't put no price on past illness because I was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. I hear to say some God saying back then, sin and go. I want to have Jesus and sin and go.
Yes.
I hear to say some
yes.
God. When I was sold into sin and I was sold into darkness, it was
the blood
that translated me from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. It was the blood that
put
my feet on a miry clay and placed them on a rock and said, oh my God! Oh,
God.
The blood of Jesus.
The blood.
I get excited when I talk about the blood.
Yeah.
I get excited when we talk about the cross.
Yes.
I get excited when we talk about the Son of God.
Yes.
Come on, say some God.
Yes,
I don't want these words to slip.
Yes,
my God, my God.
I told my wife this morning, I thank God for the saints.
Yes, Lord.
Well, you can be around the saints that's living right.
Yes,
Lord.
And it can encourage your heart.
Yes, Lord.
I thank God for the saints who is contending for the faith.
Yes, Lord.
Who have now backed off God's word.
Yes.
And is still not going to be moved. His holiness of hell. It's still the blood of Jesus. It's still the cross. Did you hear me? I still stand on the word of God. I still stand on prayer. I still stand on fasting. I still stand on seeking God. Can you hear me? Say, God.
My God. Thank you. Thank you,
Jesus.
Thank you,
Jesus. If you just can see Jesus. If you just can look to Jesus. For we see Jesus, who was made a little lower than angels for the suffering of death. Jesus, angels worship him. Don't y'all worship no angels. The angels worship him. And the only reason why he was made a little lower than an angel, because he came and got into the body of a man. These women, saints, God, so he can die for us. Jesus is the Son of God and the Son of man. He's all man and all God. Let me show you that he's all man and all God. Because he was man enough to be sleep down there in the boat.
My God.
When the storms are raging. We know God don't sleep, because the Bible says God never sleep no slumber. But Jesus, the man, was down there in the boat on a pillow sleep because he was tired. And the storms began to rise up. The disciples went to Jesus. They said, don't you care that we perish? As man, he was sleeping in the boat. But as God, he got up and rebuked the winds. He says, God, because Jesus was the Son of Man. Samaria, sat down at the well. The Bible said he sat down because he was weary. Now we know God don't get tired. But Jesus, a man, he got tired. But as God, he told the Samaritan woman, go call your husband and I'm going to give you living water. Because as God, he can give you living water. She said, come see a man that taught me everything that I did. As man, he was tired. But as God, he read her whole life.
Yes, Lord.
As man.
Yes, Lord.
They spit on him.
My God.
They pulled his beard out.
Yes, Lord.
They whooped his back with a cat of nine tails.
Come on.
Put a crown of thorns on his head.
Yes, Lord.
As man, they slapped him around and nailed his hands to the cross and nailed his feet to the cross and stuck a spear in his side. And as man, he died on that cross.
Yes, Lord.
But when they put him in that tomb, as God, he rose from the dead.
My God.
He looked and said to God, I want you to understand that Jesus. I want you to get a true understanding about our Lord and Savior, Jesus, that he was all man and all God. And right now in heaven, he still got the wounds.
Yes, Lord.
So you think that he left that body. He still got that body. It don't got blood in it, but he got a spiritual body.
Yes, Lord.
This is the reason why the Bible said that Jesus is our great high priest who sit on the right hand side of God, making intercessions for us. Because when the enemy come in like a flood, and say, God, this person is living wrong. And I got a right to go in and kill them. Jesus stand up as your great high priest and said, Father, look at my hands. He said, they nailed my hand to the cross for them. He said, Father, look at my feet. They nailed my feet to the cross for them. He said, look at my side.
Yes.
And stuck me in the side. Come on, say, so God, you have a great high priest.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, my God.
He was made a Lord and an angel. Because he was made a man. For suffering. Jesus did not come to save angels. When they sinned, God cast them out of heaven. Cast them down to hell. Put them in chains of darkness. Be with me. But when we sinned, God sent Jesus to die for our sins. Oh my God. For the suffering. That he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. The Bible says appointed to man wants to die. Then after that the judgment. We supposed to die, and then we get judged. But Jesus came and died for us. Then when we die, and we stand before God, and you need an advocate. Jesus is your advocate.
He's your
lawyer. You're going to need an advocate on that day. When you stand before God, you better hope Jesus comes stand beside you. You better hope he says, I'll plead the blood of Jesus for this way to your Father. You hear me, says God. Because Jesus is a lawyer who never lost a case. Come on, say, God. He died for you.
Yes, Lord.
My God.
Verse 10, for it became of him. We come to a close, but I want to give you the word.
Come on, sir.
For whom are all things?
Yes.
And by whom all things are.
Yes, Lord.
This is God now. It pleased God to bruise Jesus.
Yes,
it pleased
Lord.
God to send him to die for our sin. And bring him in his son to glory.
Hallelujah.
To make the captain of our salvation perfect through suffering.
Yes.
Saints of God, it pleased God.
Yes,
for Jesus to come to be wounded
for
our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities.
The Bible said without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin.
Then
sin cannot be forgiven unless God see the blood. The Bible said in Leviticus, inside of the blood is the life. Somebody's life had to be given for what Adam and Eve did. And it had to be a perfect life. It had to be perfect blood. Jesus came with perfect blood. And when he died for our sins and conquered death, oh grave, where is your victory?
Where is your victory?
Oh death, where is your sting?
Yes, Lord.
Because Jesus conquered death.
Yes, Lord.
And since he conquered death, God said, you are qualified to be the great high priest.
Yes, Lord.
The high priest will go into the holies of holies with their blood on their atonement and put their blood on the mercy seat. He went through three courts, the outer court, the inner court, and the holies of holies. And Jesus had to do the same thing.
Yes,
he got their blood.
Yes, Lord.
Passed through the first heaven. Passed through the second heaven where the stars and the moon and the planets at. And he passed all the way to the third heaven. And when he got to the third heaven, they was waiting for Jesus. The angel was standing at attention. They said, our Savior is coming back. And when Jesus walked through the gates, they said, lift up your head on your gates. And be lifted up your everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. And the angels and the cherubims and the seraphim said, who is the King of glory? They said, the Lord is strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your head on your gates. And be lifted up your everlasting doors. And the King of glory shall come in. Who is the King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty. The Lord mighty in battle.
Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah,
to Jesus.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Who is the captain of your salvation?
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Saints of God.
Yes, Lord.
Get your eyes.
Yes.
Off what's around you.
My God.
Yes, Lord.
Get your eyes off the world.
Get on Jesus.
Get your eyes off what you see and I'm doing in the streets and in the club. Get your eyes off that man. He can't save you.
Yes, Lord.
Get your eyes off that woman. They can't save you. You got to look unto Jesus.
My God.
He's the other Prince of Peace.
Yeah.
When you need peace.
My God.
He's out your joy.
Yes, Lord.
Unspeakable joy.
Yes,
if we just give God a chance.
Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
I came to God. I gave God a chance.
Yes, Lord.
And I found out his word is true.
Word is
true. I tried Islam. It did not work. I tried bumpy face, it did not work.
Come on.
I tried tough willy. You said, what's tough willy? T.W. Samuels. I tried Mary Jane.
Yes.
I tried a woman. I tried money.
Yes,
I tried a job, but it didn't fill up that empty spot.
Come on.
I'm a brother from the streets.
Yes,
and I'm not going to serve a God that's not real.
Yes,
I'm telling you, Jesus is real.
He's real.
When I came to him, the burden on my chest seemed like it just lifted.
Yes.
And the yokes that held me, they was destroyed.
Yes.
And the chains was broken. And the fetters was broken. The anger that I had in my heart, God moved that anger, that unforgiveness, and that bitterness. You hear me say, God, I'm talking about Jesus.
My God.
I want you to redirect your focus.
Yes, Lord.
And say, from this day forward, I'm looking unto Jesus.
Yes. Yes.
If you need prayer, I want you to come. If you need prayer.